This photo was taken July 4th, 16 years ago. We are watching the Powderhorn Park fireworks with dear friends, covering our ears because it was so loud, and I am holding my daughter, Josephine. She was a brand new U.S. citizen and had been in our country for only 9 days. Oh, what a crazy time for this little human. And I love in this photo how the light from the fireworks is illuminating us. And I remember loving all the possibilities branching out before Josephine. 16 years later, our country is very different. And her future looks very different. And I'm trying very hard to hold on to what is good, hope for the best for our country, and continuing to fight for all the possibilities for her future.
All you who are thirsty, come to the water. You who have no money, come, receive grain and eat. Come without paying and without cost, drink wine and milk. Come to me heedfully, that you may have life. If you bestow your bread on the hungry and satisfy the afflicted, then light shall rise for you in the darkness, and the gloom shall become for you like midday. Then the Lord will guide you always and give you plenty, even on the parched land. The Lord will renew your strength, and you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring whose water never fails. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets in which to dwell. The book of Isaiah.
Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuge of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door. The New Colossus by Emma Lazarus.
For we come on a ship they call Mayflower. We come on a ship that sails the moon. We come in the ages most uncertain hours. And we sing an American tune. Oh, but it's all right. It's all right. You can't be forever blessed. Still, tomorrow's gonna be another working day. I'm trying to get some rest. That's all I'm trying, to get some rest.
Today we lift up the American dream and the American reality. The American reality is that the dream was not intended for everyone. From our beginning, the United States of America and many American Christians denied the full humanity and dignity of all but landowning white men. Today, some American Christians claim our faith to uphold racism, white supremacy, toxic nationalism. We are now in a time of reckoning with what true patriotism demands of us as Americans and as people of faith.
From Dr. Martin Luther King, the church must be reminded that it is not the master or the servant of the state, but rather the conscience of the state, the guide and the critic. We are the church. We must be the conscience of the state, the guide, and the critic.
From Reverend Jim Wallace of Sojourners, the United States was founded by the near genocide of one people and the kidnapping and enslavement of another. This was America's original sin, and it still has a major impact on our lives today. We need space for lament, and that we must press onward toward a vision for repair and healing.
Reverend William Barber says, "The goal of true democracy has not been an easy thing. This is why in that hymn, America, the poet pleaded for God's grace, called upon us as a nation not to be arrogant and to live in a sense of false exceptionalism. In every moment of history, many had to stand up and demand that America mend her flaws, not because they were not patriotic, but because they were. They saw that patriotism is far more than blind allegiance. We must love this nation enough to take a knee and to call this nation to the knee of repentance."
We are the church. We are the conscience of the state, the guide and critic.
From Rachel Carson, written in 1953, "To sin by silence when we should protest makes coward of us. The human race has climbed on protest. The few who dare must speak and speak again to right the wrongs of many. Therefore, I do protest against the boast of independence in this mighty land. Call no chain strong which holds one rusted link. Call no land free that holds one fettered slave."
We are the church. We are the conscience of the state, the guide, and the critic.
I don't know a soul who's not been better. Don't have a friend who feels at ease. I don't know a dream that's not been shattered or driven to its knees. Oh, but it's all right. It's all right. For we've lived so well, so long. Still, when I think of the road we're traveling on, I wonder what's gone wrong. Can't help but wonder what's gone wrong.
America needs a different story. We need the story of the daily struggle of ordinary people, the young workers, elders and parents, families and communities, searching for dignity and fairness in a cruel market world. We are on a great journey. For those who came before us and for those who follow, our moral, political, and religious duty is to make sure that this nation is in good hands on our watch. Our story is that the promise of America leaves no one out. Bill Moyers.
From author J. Michelson, "Our America is worth celebrating. It is the home of Sojourner Truth and Harvey Milk, Samuel Gompers, and Elie Wiesel. It is a place in an idea still in formation. I am a Christian, and I know that there are many more like me who must stand up and speak up and act out in the way fitting a follower of Christ. I see resistance as patriotic because it demands that our country live up to its values. The war protester is a patriot. The Occupy activist was a patriot. I would add the Black Lives Matter protester is a patriot. The union organizer is a patriot. The attorneys and religious sisters fighting for the dignity of immigrants at our southern border are all patriots. Real patriotism is a belief in the possibility of our new ideals becoming real."
So what is ours to do in this time, in this place? We have to change the story. We must reclaim what it means to be a follower of Christ and a patriotic American. We join with the principles of Catholic social teaching and with all those who came before us in the great communion of saints and prophets.
Vincent Harding died in 2015. He was an author and professor, a historian, spiritual director, and activist in the civil rights movement, and he believed deeply in clouds of witnesses that surround us and uphold us when we act for God's justice. In 1985, he wrote an article on a text from the book of Hebrews that describes our heroes of faith. He wrote,
"Here are the people. Here are the beautiful, suffering, overcoming people. Faithful ones tortured, suffering, mocking, chains, imprisonment, death. What a wild company we belong to. I mean, do you understand? These are the founders of our faith. These are the old alumni, these wild, persecuted, afflicted, impractical people. In the midst of everything that seems so difficult and overwhelming, they are saying to us, we are with you. There is a way through. There is a way to stand and move and hope. Don't give up, regardless of how we feel. We are never alone, nowhere, no how, in nothing. Never, never alone."
This is from Cure at Troy by Seamus Heaney. History says, don't hope on this side of the grave. But then, once in a lifetime, the longed-for tidal wave of justice can rise up, and hope and history rhyme. So hope for a great sea change on the far side of revenge. Believe that a farther shore is reachable from here. Believe in miracles and cures and healing wells.
Many the time I've been mistaken, and many times confused. Yes, and I've often felt forsaken and certainly misused. Oh, but I'm all right. I'm all right. I'm just weary to my bones. You don't expect to be bright and bon vivant so far away from home, so far away from home. Oh, and it's all right, it's all right. You can't be tomorrow's gonna be another working day, and I'm trying to get some rest. That's all I'm trying, is to get some rest.